Now, moving on to the next part on linear programming. So linear programming is one category or one class of optimization problems. And linear programming is very important also in the historic development of optimization as a field. And linear programming is also a prime candidate to show what we can now do with the inequality constraints, because inequality constraints are really at the heart of linear programming. Okay, so we had seen Stigler's diet before. In the first lecture, we saw Stigler's diet. And the question there was, what is the combination of food that lets a soldier live, that fulfills all the requirements in calories, protein, calcium, and so on, but which is the cheapest such combination? And now we have the daily requirements for the 9 different nutrients that are considered. We have the nutrient content of the 77 food types, and we know the price of the food, and this gives us in total 9 plus 77 inequality constraints. So each of these here, the daily requirements of the 9 nutrients, we can write this down as an inequality constraint that the nutrient level of the food in combination has to be larger than the minimum requirement. And for the 77 food types, we can add the constraint that only positive quantities of this food can be consumed. Otherwise, I might exchange negative marmalade that is maybe expensive against positive beans that are a little bit cheaper. And obviously we cannot allow that. Okay, so for large optimization problems, and now we are still, this is still tiny. So now we are 80 something dimensions. This is still a very small problem, but it becomes problematic to write it down by hand, and we don't want to spend weeks and weeks doing the calculations by hand. We want to solve this by the computer. But even when we think about the problem on paper, we'd like to have a shorthand notation that states the problem a bit more compact, and where we still have a good way to think about and reason and talk about the problem with a compact notation. And also, linear programming is not only a shorthand notation, it is also a standard form understood by many software packages. So it's a standard way to express a certain type of optimization problem, and then I can choose between different algorithms that all understand the type of problem definition. Okay, so Stigler's diet in detail. For the objective function, we are looking to minimize the cost of the overall diet. So let's assume we know the cost of every food type, and the food type is here indicated by J as an index. So J is between 1 and 77. And we know the cost of every food type, and we put the C, J together to a vector. So we have C1, C2, C3, and so on in a column vector that contains all the cost for the different types of food. Meaning, when we then have decided on an overall diet X that contains the number of food for every category, so here X would then also be a column vector where all the entries correspond to the different food types, then the overall cost of this diet would be just C transpose X. So we transform C into a row vector, multiply that with X, and this little expression here, this is the objective function that we are minimizing, and this is actually a what is called a linear objective function. So one of the simplest types that we can have. Okay, now in addition, we have the constraints for the nutrient requirements. So for all the nutrients, we know how much food they contain, how much for every food we know how much nutrient it contains. So for every type of nutrient, So we have different nutrient categories, and the nutrient categories are called I here. For every category, we have again a column vector that contains the number of nutrients for the different foods. So up before, we had a column vector that was also for the cost that had 77 entries. So with one cost for every type of food. And now for the nutrient contents, we would then also have a 77 entry or 77 dimensional vector. But then we have a different vector for the calories. So we had one here for the calories, and then maybe another for the protein. And for each of the types of food, we have a different column vector that describes the nutrient per food type. Okay, and now we can formulate the constraint. So now we say AI transpose X has to be larger than BI. And the BI is the minimum requirement for the nutrient type I. Okay. Now, moving on, positivity constraints. These are rather straightforward. So I have 77 food types and I just add the constraint XJ larger than zero. And so overall, I have a linear optimization target function. I have 9 inequality constraints for the nutrient content, and I have 77, again, inequality constraints for the positivity. And this makes up the optimization problem of Stigler's diet. And now we compress this even more and bring it into standard form. So now we rewrite this by taking all the inequality constraints and putting them into a matrix form. So we have just seen the constraints for the different types of food. And when we rewrite this constraint, so here we are looking at this constraint here. And when we rewrite this, we can write it down as AI transpose times X minus BI has to be smaller or equal than zero. So again, here we are in standard form, smaller or equal than zero. And if we then take the AI and transpose them, then we can stack them on top of each other to form a big matrix A. And every row of this matrix A then contains one inequality constraint. And then prior, we had to consider all of the inequality constraints individually. But by putting them into this standard matrix form, we can just write down our solution set as all the solutions X, where AX minus B is smaller than zero. And now big A is a matrix, and X and B are vectors. And obviously, I'm modifying my x here, and I'm looking for all x where this equation holds for a known matrix A and a known vector B. Okay. And for the Stigler's diet, we had all the AI. So the AI were from the notation, we reused the A notation here. Previously, these were just the nutrient constraints. But also the positivity constraint for every food type can be expressed in a similar way. So I could, for the A, I could just have a matrix, for example, where I put only one entry here. So one, and otherwise I only have zeros. And in that case, if I say AX minus B is smaller than zero, that would mean X1 minus B smaller than zero for the first row. So B1, of course, the first element of B. So now looking only at the first row of this guy, it would then be equivalent to the constraint XI smaller than BI. And that way I can just express the positivity constraints of the Stigler diet in the same fashion in one big matrix and integrate all my inequality constraints that I have for this problem into one simple expression, because now overall my optimization problem, it looks like this. I minimize f of x subject to ax minus b smaller than 0, and this is the compact form for linear programming. Okay, this was quite a bit. You will also solve Stigler's diet or a variation of Stigler's diet for yourself. So this will be a problem for the exercises. But now let's look at a little more at what linear programming does and how we can visually think about linear programming. We have our linear problem C transpose X that we want to minimize, and we have our constraints, and every row of my matrix and every entry of the vector B now defines a plane in the solution space, and it is excluding a half space. So all the blue points here, or all the shaded area here, would be excluded. And again, I do that many times, take the intersection of the remaining set, and then I get like a polytope, and all my results have to lie in that polytope. In this case here, the solution set is closed on every side, but I can also imagine an example where I have, let's draw this differently, where I have where here I have x1 and x2, and my constraints are, for example, that my solution has to be outside of the shaded area, and then my solution set would be open. So then on this end here, my solution set would be unconstrained, and I could walk out to infinity over there. But I won't have a problem in that case if my optimization problem forces me inside the barrier. So for the linear programming, if I can, I would walk infinitely far along in the direction where my solutions are getting better. So for linear programming, I actually do need the constraints. Otherwise, if this was unconstrained, if I only had C transposed X as the optimization with no constraints, then I would walk straight out into infinity if I'm not on a exactly flat line. And therefore, I need the constraints to have a well-defined solution. And I also need the optimization problem to walk into the constraints. But this is often designed into the optimization problem. So when we state the optimization problem, we already have that in mind. Okay. So for a long time, it was believed that the boundary between efficiently solvable problems and the very complicated hard problems was the difference between linear and nonlinear. Today, we rather believe that the boundary is between convex versus non-convex problems. So today, we say that the convex problems are efficiently solvable and the non-convex problems are not efficiently solvable. But for many years, until, let's say, the late 80s even, in many circles, it was believed that the linear problems, only the linear problems, were efficiently solvable. Today, we are a bit further than that. Today, also many convex problems that are nonlinear can be solved efficiently, but from a historical perspective, the linear problems are very important. Many practical applications can make use of that. They don't require nonlinear optimization, but also the solution methods for linear problems were the first to reach a level of maturity where on an industrial scale the methods could be used. Okay, where does the name linear programming come from? So if you are students of computer science, so most of you, you will understand programming to be the development of computer code, of program code. But linear programming is obviously something very different. But why this overlap in naming or this name confusion? Well, actually, the programming term for linear programming is much older than the programming term for computer programming. So originally, the military referred to plans or to schedules for training, logistics, deployment of troops, and so on, as a program. And this optimization of the programs of the military was one of the very first applications for the tools that we today call linear programming and for the type of problem that we today call linear programming. And George Danzig, which is one of the grandfathers of optimization, he first called this approach programming in a linear structure. And later on, a colleague of him, Koopmans, he proposed to shorten the name to linear programming, something more catchy. And in science, sometimes you need your science to have a sexy name to catch on. And in that case, linear programming did take on, and today it is the term used for the type of problem that George Danzig has been solving at the time. So George Danzig was also the inventor of the simplex algorithm. And he developed that during World War II, and actually the military kept the algorithm secret until 1947, and it was then published in the 50s. Because it was of such importance to the war effort, and they wouldn't want to leave this algorithm to optimize the military programs to the enemy. Okay, so what does this simplex algorithm do? How does it work? The inner workings of the simplex algorithm are much more tuned to linear programming. So the barrier method that we saw earlier, or the interior point method that we saw earlier, it can be applied to a wide variety of different problems. So the resource allocation problem that we solved early on in the lecture, this was already a non-linear optimization problem. But the simplex algorithm, it only works for the linear optimization problems, and it exploits the insight that the solutions will always lie at the intersection of several constraints. Well, I have to explain that a little bit. If I have a constraint that is exactly orthogonal to the direction into which the optimization objective function is forcing me, then the actual solution can lie on all the points here on this line, or on this plane in a higher dimension. But if I have a search direction that is not entirely orthogonal to the constraint, then, so this again is the constraint, and this would be my search direction, then I would move over here and here and here and get better and better and better until I walk into another constraint. I'm now excluding all the solutions outside here. And the optimum, you can imagine, the optimum has to lie then exactly here at the intersection of these two constraints. And the idea of the simplex algorithm is to walk along the edges and to take a direction or to select the next edge in a way that I'm always improving on the solution. So here we are starting at some point, walking over to the next vertex along the edge, walking over, walking over, walking over, and the simplex algorithm, it defines a way to select the next edge. And there are, you can even do that on paper for smaller problems, and this has a big impact, and for a big part of the 20th century this was heavily used in industry and military context and so on. people won Nobel Prizes for that. Yeah, so for example, Koopmans, which was mentioned on the previous slide, and also Kantorowicz, they defined important optimization problems in economy and jointly won the Nobel Prize for Economics in 1975. And Kantorowicz, for example, he was famous for employing the optimization methods in Russia, in the UdSSR, to optimize the economy. So this was on a state level used for economic planning. Okay, the simplex algorithm. Why are we not learning about that here in this lecture? First of all, it is constrained to the linear programming case, and we are looking at a much wider class of optimization problems here. And also, it was found out in the 70s, so Klee is the author here, it was found out in the 70s that we can construct synthetic problems where the simplex algorithm has an exponential runtime. So this rarely occurs in practical problems, but by carefully constructing the problem, we can have exponential runtime. And this is a drawback because we don't have any guarantees. So sometimes your algorithm, it needs a guarantee to converge within a certain time or to get to a good enough solution in a certain time. So for example, in a safety critical context or in an automatic control problem, you want to be able to guarantee that within, I don't know, a tenth of a second, you have a good solution. And with a simplex algorithm, you cannot, the bounds you get for the runtime are pretty bad, because it could always be that you run into a case where the runtime is exponential in the number of the constraints and the variables. And today's algorithms don't have this drawback. And today's algorithms have reached or even surpassed the average runtime of the simplex algorithm, and they generalize to also to the nonlinear problems, and they don't have the drawback of the exponential runtime. So it was in 1988, some researcher at IBM published the first algorithm that showed polynomial runtime for the linear programming problem, or the first polynomial runtime that was acceptable. And this triggered a big revolution in the optimization field. The problem then was Karmarkha was the name of the researcher. He patented his algorithm. And so IBM and Karmarkha patented the approach. And but within month and the first year, people found improvements that were no longer covered under the patent. And today patenting is no longer a problem in the field of optimization. Okay, but the simplex algorithm that was briefly explained here, it is to us mostly of historical interest, and we will not learn it in this course, and we will also not force you to learn the algorithm and apply it in the exam or similar things.